At some point in our lives, we inevitably face the ultimate question. Why are we here? Where did we come from? And somewhere out there, in the terrifying unknown, is there a God? Sure, we have our faith, but we may never know until we face oblivion. We may never truly be able to comprehend that somewhere out there, there exists someone, something, that had no beginning and will have no end. An entity that has always been there and has existed anywhere and everywhere at any given moment. But there is one person who may know. He's always been there. At any given moment, he is anywhere and everywhere. He was in that science fiction movie you caught at 2 in the morning. He was in that awful sitcom you left on in the background as you cooked dinner. He's been in children's movies, video games, police dramas, medical shows, from big blockbusters to films best left untouched in the dollar bin at Walmart. He's been in videos for obscure YouTube channels. He's at conventions around the globe signing your autograph. He's down the street. He's in your house. He's inside you. He's inside all of us. And his name is James Motherfucking Hong. Simply put, with over 400 credits on IMDb, James Hong is one of the hardest working actors in show business. And the thing is, that current number doesn't include individual episodes of TV shows. When you factor those in, you get a final total of 621 projects. And today, at the time this episode was released, on February 22nd, 2017, James Hong is 88 years old and still acting. The man is a legend, and trying to make a biography about him is a monumental task. There's a lot of stuff we need to talk about besides his life and career. Imagine that we're cleaning up a basement. Somewhere buried in this f***ing mess is the full story of James Hong. The only thing is, as we discover more of his story, there's a bunch of this other s*** that we're gonna need to get out of the way. And just a heads up before we start, a big source for all my information came from this interview conducted with James in 2013 by the Archive of American Television. If you're interested in watching the full interview, the links are in the description. Alright, let's start with this one. James Hong actually wasn't made in China. He was made in Minneapolis, Minnesota on February 22nd, 1929. His parents emigrated to America from Hong Kong.
Oh, my father's name was Frank Hong. Chinese name, Fuk Hong. He was a restaurant man. His first occupation was as a laundryman, as usual in those days. And then he kept going and became a cook and owned his own restaurant. Yeah, my mother's name is Lei Sui Fa. She was a picture bride in those early days. And so he went back and got her and then brought her over and from there is history.
When James was 5 years old, his family picked up and moved back to China for a period of time.
When I was about 5 years old, my father decided to take me and the rest of the family back to Hong Kong, Kowloon, because he thought we were becoming too Americanized. So I was put into the Yeokji grade school. So I attended grade school in Kowloon for about 4 years.
When James was very young, he loved listening to the old serial programs on the radio.
We listened to gather around the radio just as if it was a TV, and there was one that called Inner Sanctum Mystery. And it started something like this. Welcome to Inner Sanctum Mystery. I got on one of the local radio shows where they, like nowadays, you would have America's Got Talent, that type of thing, with Cedric Adams' Stairway to Stardom. And I was one of the contestants, and I did my impersonations. I did Inner Sanctum Mystery, and then I did Jimmy Stewart, Jimmy Stewart, that's my name. Yeah. It's oddly enough, but the rest is history.
My name is Peter Lonely. I am going man. All right, Joe. You dirty rats.
He kept performing as he attended Minnesota Central High School, eventually doing impersonations on radio shows, as well as on stage as a stand-up comedian. He would go on to study civil engineering at the University of Minnesota, but it wasn't necessarily his idea.
I attended the University of Minnesota and studied civil engineering, of all things. I know my parents wanted me to study engineering, you know, be a doctor, be a lawyer, be an engineer, but don't be an actor. Because in China, being an actor is the lowest rung in life. Why? Because you're demonstrating your feelings and you're spilling everything, which is a no-no in the early days. You know, you're supposed to be reserved and keep everything to yourself and not be over-expressionalistic, so as to say.
But that didn't stop James from performing. He kind of did it on the side. He even continued to perform when he served in the Korean War in the early 50s. Because of his talent, his general kept him at Camp Rucker and put him in charge of live shows instead of sending him overseas. James says that this decision probably saved his life.
Had I gone to Korea, I probably would have been shot, as you know, because if I charged the enemies, the North Koreans would shoot me. If we were called to retreat, then the Americans would think I am, you know, a gook and shoot me also. So I think I would have been dead from both sides. But General Peterson saved my life, and so did Major Petiri. And so I served my 18 months in the Army with the special services, organizing the live shows for both camps. That gave me an ability to sort of, you know, be with show business, be exposed to all the guys from New York, Hollywood, and so forth. It led to me to sort of fulfill my dreams one day to be in either New York or Hollywood instead of being in Minnesota.
After serving for 18 months in the Korean War, in 1953, James moved to Los Angeles with a friend and eventually appeared on You Bet Your Life with Groucho Marx, doing a Groucho Marx impersonation. For a time, James was still working as a civil engineer, pursuing show business on the side. He eventually made the decision to jump into acting completely.
I wasn't really doing what I wanted to do in engineering, civil engineering. I had visions of building bridges and, you know, and getting out to the field and, you know, really build things. As a kid, I liked to build things, but you were stuck in that office in civil service where I began to fall asleep on the job. I had to pinch myself to keep myself awake and then quickly run to the theater or practice my nightclub act. And so that, I think, led me to deciding I have to do something to pursue what I love.
So James decided one day to quit his job as a civil engineer and go headfirst into acting. It was a risky move, but it paid off immediately.
Okay, we emptied that box. Let's see what this big one is. That's a big topic. All right, let's get into it.
So early on in film, I'm talking about the silent era. There were already some stereotypes of the Chinese out there, brewing in American society. In the late 1800s, the amount of Chinese immigrants was growing, some of them going to California to work in the gold fields, others working on the Transcontinental Railroad, and their presence invoked a certain amount of fear and mistrust, which carried over into the early 20th century, and took the form of anti-Chinese press and comics. Now this went on for a while. As we get into the 1930s and 40s, things got a little more specific. Let's take a look at what was, at one point, the most popular fictional character in the world. Charlie Chan. Charlie Chan started out as a series of novels, eventually being adapted into a series of films and TV shows. The main character was Charlie Chan, a Chinese detective who solves crimes.
Dart aimed at face, but doctor, attracted by electrical display behind chair, turned head, was struck here.
The films were a mixed bag as far as representing Chinese people in a good light. On one hand, Charlie Chan's family is portrayed by a cast of actual Asian actors, and they're all nice people and well-educated. On the other hand, the character of Charlie Chan was portrayed in an exaggerated fashion by white actors. There's no need to get into this yet. So the stereotype perpetuated by Charlie Chan was pretty much acting like Confucius, like some wise Chinese master.
I've just received information which leads me to believe that she's in New York. The is like finding a needle in a haystack.
Needle can be found when correct thread located.
Then came World War II. Now take a wild guess at what happened here. Much like how the Germans became popular villains after the war, so did the Japanese. As a result, Chinese actors would not only go out for Chinese roles, but for Japanese roles. Then 5 years after that war ended, we had the Korean War, which lasted until 1953. Subsequently, there were a lot of films and TV programs that dealt with the Korean War as well, which meant casting for Korean characters. All of this was awesome for James Hong, who, as a Chinese actor getting into acting in the early 50s, was cast not just as Chinese characters, but Japanese and Korean characters. So, he got a lot of acting work pretty much because Western audiences didn't know the difference between Asian races.
So, are you Chinese or Japanese?
And you know what? We haven't even talked about the stereotypes for Chinese women yet. Here's a short summary. For the early days, Chinese women were seen as humble, quiet, reserved, and shy. They're there to pretty much serve their man. It was like that for a while until the 60s, when thanks to films like The World of Susie Wong and Flower Drum Song, Chinese women were all of a sudden seen as very exotic creatures. Also there to not only serve men, but to seduce them. This is an image that persisted for a long time. In the same way, with a character like Charlie Chan, Westerners manufactured this Chinese stereotype. So roles like Charlie Chan just reinforced this false image over and over again, to the point where audiences just assumed that this was an accurate representation of a Chinese man. So this is what was going on in the 50s and 60s. Not a lot of diversity, not a lot of lead roles for Chinese people, or Asians in general. There were Asian actors who found success in larger roles, like Japanese actor James Shigeta, who played romantic leads, or Japanese actor Mako, who was nominated for an Oscar in 1966 for his role in The Sand Pebbles. But these guys were the exceptions. Actors like James Hong, George Takei, and Richard Liu were all go-to guys when a production needed someone of Asian descent playing a character. Aha! I knew this was in here somewhere. So what are some of the early roles that James Hong played? His first few roles were in feature films, very short appearances, and little to no dialogue.
The first three features I had were sort of a conglomerate so-called breakthroughs. Why? Because it gave me a chance to do feature motion pictures. The first feature I did was with Clark Gable in Soldier of Fortune.
Hello. And you are? Hello, hello. Chikala.
Small role, but I was on the telephone as a communist soldier. The second film was Blood Alley with John Wayne and Lauren Bacall. I had a better role there. It just came one right after another. So Hollywood was hiring me for all kinds of roles. That Love as a Man is a Splendid Thing, I play the nephew of Jennifer Jones. So I was seen. So you might say those three features sort of like, here is James Hong, you know.
Something that I think helped James get more work was the fact that he was fluent in two languages. If needed, he could speak perfect Chinese, whether he's supposed to be threatening, like in the 1955 film Blood Alley, or begging for his life in an episode of Zorro. On the other hand, he could speak English very well, with an accent or without. Here he is in the war film Never So Few with Frank Sinatra, playing a Chinese general.
These warrants were issued to the troops of independent Chinese generals, whose integrity cannot be questioned.
Warlords.
For the purpose of prosecuting enemies of the Chinese Republic.
He has a slight accent, which works for the role. There are also roles where he pretty much eliminated any trace of an accent.
Suddenly, the Frenlow Willow Tree offers her a fan. A magic fan, with which she can render the dragon completely helpless.
So already by the late 50s, he could play a wide range of characters, and arguably his biggest job during this period was when he was in over 30 episodes of The New Adventures of Charlie Chan, playing Charlie's eldest son.
You know, Pop, after looking at the Soderheim again, I got a theory.
Well, you usually have, my son.
So already, with James Hong's early roles, I was surprised at what I saw. I was expecting to find a whole lot worse. It's easy to see things like this and think, wow, Hollywood sucked.
Oh, darling, I am sorry, but I lost my key.
But that was 2 weeks ago! You cannot go on or keep ringing my bell! You disturb me! You must have a key made!
The thing is, of what I had watched so far of James Hong, none of it seemed offensive at all. Most of his roles made sense. Roles like General Chow in Never So Few. He played a Chinese general. Makes sense to me. Or his role as a nightclub owner in Chinatown in an episode of Peter Gunn.
Hello, Pete. I'm glad you could make it.
Hi, Johnny.
Edie, this is Johnny Chang. He's the owner of the Green Dragon. Johnny, this is Edie Hart.
How do you do, Miss Hart?
I don't see anything wrong with these roles individually. There were also a few instances where projects that James Hong acted in were obviously trying to flip the script and portray Chinese people in a more three-dimensional light. Take something like this episode of the Western drama Johnny Ringo. Our hero Johnny guns down two cowboys for no apparent reason and is asked to explain himself. In flashback, he tells the story of what the two men actually did: drive a hard-working American-Chinese family off of their own land.
Mr. Bird, please. You do not understand. This land is not for sale. Mr. Jacobs gave us this land to work. This is our home.
Your home is 5,000 miles west.
America is our home. We are Americans now.
The point I'm trying to make is that all these different Asian roles in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, they weren't all racist, but what they all were limiting. They were roles in which there needed to be some unspoken explanation of why we were seeing an Asian character on the screen. It's almost like an Asian character wouldn't be in a film unless the main characters happened to be in an Asian country, or Chinatown, or a certain restaurant, or the film took place during a certain time period. There weren't a lot of opportunities for Asians to be the lead in something, and some would argue that that problem hasn't necessarily gone away. You guys, this is a long episode. Let's take a short Tai Chi break.
That's a little Tai Chi break once in a while to get focused and settle down.
All right, so let's take a look at the early 60s through the early 70s. Now, the 60s were really more of the same. One-off roles on TV shows, a few lines in a movie here and there, while increasing or decreasing the strength of his accent, depending on what the role called for.
Those early roles were pretty much the same type of roles, but at least it kept me working, and you know, I just got up and running with those roles.
Some of these roles were more dignified, like when he played scientists in a couple of B-movies, The Satan Bug and Colossus, The Forbidden Project, and he played a doctor in an episode of The Bill Cosby Show. These are roles that could have been played by anybody of any race or color or gender, size or frequency, anybody. They also didn't require an explanation as to why an Asian was playing them. Then, on the other end of the spectrum, you had the usual limiting roles, some of them making sense depending on the context, like being a tour guide in China in an episode of the sci-fi show One Step Beyond, a Chinese agent helping some Americans find a flying saucer in the sci-fi B-movie The Bamboo Saucer, and a spy for the Chinese government in an episode of The Outer Limits. Other roles were most certainly stereotypical, like his role in a 1960 episode of Bonanza.
Mr. Horse, number three cousin, he like to talk to you.
何先生,我好,歡迎有機會來見你,你真的強壯啊,我一世沒見到人有一咁強壯啊。
Part of it makes sense because our main characters spend the episode in 1861 San Francisco, in a part of town with a heavy population of Chinese immigrants. That's at least historically accurate, but there's just something about the way it was done, the broken English, the bowing, the reversing of the L's and R's, the music, and I swear, every single time James Hong appears on screen, a gong plays.
Mr. Horst! Mr. Horst!
Where's Paul?
They finding a good look later.
Okay.
You follow me. Come.
I get that this is all supposed to be over the top, but I don't blame Chinese actors for looking at something like this and being frustrated. There were also two projects I found in which James played Japanese characters. One of them was pretty straightforward, playing a soldier in an episode of The Wackiest Ship in the Army.
Admiral Ozuma, after great trouble, has found American film. You will all be his guest.
Then this one's interesting.
Interesting!
A legal word!
Interesting is a non-word. You know you're supposed to avoid it. Be specific.
Yeah, alright, it's unusual, and I don't know how to feel about it. He played a Japanese neighbor in the Donna Reed Show.
I know of a vacation place where there are almost no golf courses. It is my homeland, a country of ancient culture and peaceful traditions.
Oh, Jim, thank you for the suggestion, but I'm afraid we can't afford to go all the way to Japan.
Japan? I'm talking about Mexico City.
You were born in Mexico City?
Oh, my mother makes the best Japanese entouradas you have ever tasted.
Listen to how he speaks. His voice is deeper, and he speaks a different kind of broken English from when he plays Chinese characters.
Yeah, why don't you mind your own business anyhow?
This is my business. You want to
I wonder how he felt about doing this, and I'm sure he beat out other actors who were actually Japanese. One project that James Hong was fortunate to be a part of in the 60s was the 1966 Oscar-nominated film The Sand Pebbles. It was a war film nominated for 8 Academy Awards, and it had a lot to say about some of the negative effects of imperialism, as well as racism.
Gotta train a new coolie.
What?
Yeah, one of them slow pits. Can't do it, Frenchie. They think that engine's got ghosted.
James Hong was effective as a sleazy owner of a prostitution ring in 1920s China, offering his most prized prostitute, a virgin, to the highest bidder.
Well, how about it, sailor?
Alright, there are so many other projects in the late 60s through early 80s to mention, so I'm gonna start with the more recognizable projects he worked on, then we'll take a look at some more obscure stuff. Hong's career in the 70s kicked off nicely, largely thanks to this man. Bruce Lee is commonly credited for popularizing the kung fu genre, starting with his first film, The Big Boss, and before his death, the legendary Enter the Dragon. As a result of kung fu's popularity, there were similar productions that popped up in America, which provided plenty of work for Asian actors, especially James Hong. One such production was the TV series Kung Fu, starring David Carradine, who played a Shaolin monk traveling through the Old West. The show actually has some questionable origins, with Bruce Lee's widow claiming that the series was originally going to be a vehicle for her late husband, but the studio was nervous about hiring an Asian lead in an American TV series. Whatever the case, James Hong was in 9 episodes, every time playing a different character.
The producer stopped me one day at the studio, and he said, James, I just want to compliment you. He says, having you in a show is like having gold in my pocket. Every time they run into trouble of finding an actor to do a role, get James Hong, you know. And they trusted me to do everything, in a sense, in Kung Fu, anywhere from a villain to a sympathetic vagrant who was stealing food, or to a sympathetic tortured Chinaman in those days, and anything, you know?
Some other big projects in the 70s and early 80s include Chinatown, in which James appeared briefly as Khan, Evelyn's butler.
JJ, get us to see Mr. Mulray.
Not a lot of dialogue, but enough to get the sense of his character, a loyal Chinese butler who doesn't speak a lot of English. In 1976, he played a small role as the owner of a chili restaurant in the Oscar-nominated biopic about musician Woody Guthrie, Bound for Glory.
Have some onion and crackers. Put lots of onion in it. Tastes good that way.
And in 1980, he played a Japanese general in Airplane.
Well, I could go on for hours, but I'd probably start to bore you. You know, I really couldn't blame Elaine if she wanted a career.
No dialogue, but a good sight gag. These may have been some big films, but like any reliable character actor, Hong's bread and butter was episodic roles in TV. He was given a lot more screen time, and as a result, plenty of opportunities to showcase his abilities. He was in a lot of sitcoms, honing his comedic timing, while also subverting stereotypes that had previously been established. Some examples of this include 2 separate appearances on All in the Family.
See that guy there? What's he doing here?
Oh.
The chink over there. What's a chink doing here?
What, you mean a Chinese man?
All right, whatever. I was just wondering what he was doing here.
Well, he's here the same as everybody else to give blood.
Oh, no. He ain't gonna give no blood here.
What are you talking about? That's what everybody's here for.
Get out of here. He's an Oriental. That's a yellow race.
Oh, and of course he has yellow blood.
I was your waiter when you used to come in here.
Hey, that's right. Yeah, I didn't recognize your voice. Dude, hey, how come you ain't got no Chinese accent no more?
I don't need it now. I own the restaurant.
See how things go?
Just after all these years.
10-cent tippers you never forget.
The Bob Newhart Show.
We would kind of like a table right now. You must want the maitre d'. I'm waiting for my wife to come out of the lake. Tell you what, keep the fun.
And I love his role as a chef on this episode of Maud.
Well, I'm giving you the deluxe dinner for $8 a person. You get a real authentic Chinese dinner. Start out with shark fin soup, 1,000-year-old eggs, Peking duck, And I run around the room with a pigtail yelling, "Who want fly lice? Who want fly lice?"
Norris, I just got through telling you that this party is in honor of Irene McElhaney. We have worked side by side very hard all these years to do away with that terrible image of the ethnic stereotype. Now, I want you to serve the $8 meal, but you are not going to run around my house yelling, "Who want flied lice?" But I do like the pigtail.
Most of the other roles he played didn't really add any social commentary. My vote for his funniest TV role in the 70s has to go to Taxi. In this episode, Judd Hirsch and Danny DeVito have a competition to see who can make the most money driving their cabs in one night. Judd's character picks up James Hong, who doesn't speak a word of English.
Hi there, where you going? What's that hurry? I think I can have spring guy, got odd guy.
Oh, no, no.
English. Do you speak English?
Then he reaches a moral crossroads when James's character gives him way too much money for the cab ride.
You don't mind if I rob you blind, cheat you of all your money? Make you penniless, do you?
Hola,
you give me much money for a short ride. Now I'm talking like Tonto.
Tonto, got the high ho silver!
He's hysterical, but in the end, there's actually this slight dramatic moment when he realizes that he was almost taken advantage of. He kind of gives Judd this slight look of disappointment. Well played. As for dramatic roles, there were plenty to go around. A couple of my favorites were in two episodes of Hawaii Five-O, playing different characters in each. In one episode, he plays a guy in over his head involved in an insurance scam. He has a heart condition, and when the police start connecting the dots, he's scared shitless, sweating.
Listen, when the girls came to me, I just predated their marriage licenses, that's all.
And you got paid?
Yes, I got paid. For that, I got paid, but not for murder.
Later on, the guy who's in charge of the scam takes him out in the middle of nowhere and kills him just by scaring the shit out of him.
Take me!
The scene is hard to watch, and James is phenomenal. Then later on, in the same season of Hawaii Five-O, James plays a character that couldn't be more different, a money launderer. He's cool, calm, and collected.
The deal stands.
I need to be enlightened. What deal?
Well, Pete said it was all arranged. He said you agreed to buy the ransom money.
Did I? How much are you asking?
Well, Pete said you agreed to pay half.
Half?
Also, I'd like to bring up another Japanese role that James played in an episode of Wonder Woman. Before, on the Donna Reed Show, his portrayal was way over the top because it was a sitcom. Now, Wonder Woman isn't necessarily rooted in reality, but his Japanese character here is much more subdued, and we get a better understanding of this Japanese accent that he's able to put on.
Now, this photograph was made on old Fujika paper. That would be before the war. So, these are the microfilms for the years 1925 to 1940. These are the visas. I'm sorry, there are so many.
I'll manage.
Now, I'm no linguist, so I don't know the subtle differences between a Chinese accent and a Japanese accent, or whether or not James Hong is even accurately portraying a Japanese character. I just think it's interesting.
Interesting!
A legal word!
Interesting is a non-word. Be specific.
Alright, I used the word interesting as a general word because I'm talking about race stuff and I'm slightly uncomfortable. Before we move on to the 80s, here are a couple of honorable mentions. First, the 1973 TV movie Pueblo, based on a true Cold War incident in which an American ship was captured by the North Korean Navy in 1968. In his Archive of American Television interview, he talks about how proud he was of his performance as a North Korean general interrogating the American soldiers.
And, you know, ask them to pointedly, why and what gave you the authority to come and bomb our people?
You bombed us, invaded us, killed our children, raped our women. Where was the Geneva Convention then? All my men lost a brother or parent to your American bombs and American guns.
I tell you, the only safe place for you is here in this prison, because you Americans made yourself so hated. You continue your constant aggression. Even today, there are 50,000 American troops in South Korea. Why? Your ship exposes again the true color of American imperialism, because it is a specialized armed spy ship. You cannot deny it. You are spies sent by your government. We have your secret papers. You are entitled to nothing. You are not even worthy to be considered under the laws of civilized nations. How do you wish to be shot? Individually or all together?
In a sense, my reward as an actor, the whole cast almost, they were in character and they almost cried and felt so guilty upon hearing the logic of this speech which the officer gave them. In a sense that I knew I did a good job as that officer. Whatever your political beliefs are, it doesn't matter in that show, in the sense that this was a general or officer who was talking sense from his own being. And that's the way I played it.
Now there's one more thing that needs to be addressed. James Hong's porn career. Now, to be clear, he never actually performed in a porn, but since the early 70s, he's been involved to a certain degree. It started in that special period of time in the 70s when adult films had a story, the kind of films that Jack Horner would be proud of. James directed an adult film in 1972 called Hot Connections. Here's an interesting...
Interesting is a non-word. Be specific.
Here's a skeevy and gross plot synopsis from Don the Deviant at Something Weird Video.
Male chauvinists, beware! When the lusty ladies of the Women's Liberation Defense Center get their panties all in a twist, there's not a penis within 100 miles that's safe from their sexual wrath. So, watch out.
I've only found short clips of it, but it's about what you'd expect. I'm just curious how James got involved in this. He even has a cameo in it as a snooper. Then, a couple years later, Hong appeared as an actor in China Girl. He played Y.C. Chan, the main villain who, in an attempt to find a secret formula, has a host of women who implement sexual torture to find it.
No! Stop! I've had enough!
Now come on, if you do that to somebody long enough, they're gonna tell you anything. His character starts off British, but the accent kinda gets lost later on.
Dragon is rather surprised at the way you handled our last shipment. It seems that several kilos, 4 to be exact, disappeared while it was in your care. Unforgivable, Mr. Potter. Unforgivable.
Then 4 years later, James directed the film Teen Lust, which I guess isn't really a porn, it's more of a sex comedy. There's no actual sex in it. It's kind of on par with something like American Pie. Okay, time for another intermission. Here's a montage of James Hong dancing. As we get into the 1980s, there's another topic I want to touch on, and that's James Hong's age. As early as 1974, he entered a period of his life where he could play someone who looked his age, which was around late 40s and early 50s, but with the right makeup or prosthetics, he could play much older, and he was good at it. He did it in this episode of Starsky and Hutch, then played the old man in the film Go Tell the Spartans. These are just two early examples, but they were the start of a new phase in James's career. And while we're on the topic, I feel like this is important to bring up. James's hair. It took me a while to notice this, but he definitely wears toupees in certain roles. Rather than hindering him, it seems like it just increased his versatility. Since he went bald, he has 4 different hairstyles that I've seen. 2 of them are just made up of his real hair, switching between straight up bald or doing a comb over. The other 2 hairstyles, I'm pretty sure, are 2 separate toupees. One is this short one that parts to the side, and the other is one that is slightly longer and slicked back. It reminded me of this character actor, Matt Malloy, featured in the documentary about character actors, that guy who was in that thing. Matt went bald at a young age and has since bought a number of high-end wigs that he uses for auditions. locations. Now, I don't know for sure, but I wouldn't be surprised if James Hong does the exact same thing. One of James's old man roles is one that he's most proud of, Dr. Hannibal Chu in the 1982 sci-fi film Blade Runner. James Hong's character Hannibal is a scientist who creates the eyes for the replicants, or androids, in this alternative future of Los Angeles. Rogue replicants, led by Rutger Hauer's character Roy Batty, are trying to find someone who might have information on how to prolong their life, since they're due to expire in a short time.
Morphology, longevity, incept dates.
Don't know. I don't know such stuff. I just do eyes. Just eyes. Genetic design. Just eyes. You Nexus, huh? I design your eyes.
Chu, if only you could see what I've seen with your eyes.
What makes this character so memorable? It's because James added a real history to him. You know exactly who he is from the first few moments.
Before they came in, I was muttering in Chinese and improvising dialogue, talking to the eyeballs in Chinese dialogue. Because they were my children, right? The guy had never seen any so-called of his own children except these eyeballs, and then they jerk my pipes in the back of my costume, that which frightened me, you know. So you have to count on all those things. What do you do, in a sense, preceding the scene, which is what you learn in acting classes. What is the life preceding the scene? Where are you in that scene in the movie as your character? You have to bring all that forth so that the minute the camera is on you, the whole story is just laid out right there. Your character is very clear. And so from that moment on, the scene just ran the way that you have seen it. And when I recognized the eyeballs, my children in Rutger's eyes, you know, they were like my children. He was a friend. He was somebody I love because they are my kids. Except until he decided to kill me. And that's like your own child turning against you, you know? So those are the things that you study and manufacture as a character to make the life come true.
You see, that's brilliant. And even though he only has a few minutes of screen time, he created a real flesh and blood character that you believe has existed in this universe. Let's jump headfirst into the 80s. He continued to work regularly in bit parts here and there, 5 episodes on Dynasty as a doctor, a clerk in Breathless, an engineer in an episode of TJ Hooker. As I mentioned before, at this point, with the right makeup, he was old enough to start playing the old, wise Chinese man on the regular, like a ninja. Ninja 3, The Domination.
It is wise of you to come, O young ones.
These are necessary, in case the spirit becomes hungry.
Revenge of the Nerds 2, Nerds in Paradise.
My name's Dudley Dawson. They call me Booger.
Edgar Poe Wong. They call me Snotty.
And of course, the film that is mostly responsible for James Hong's countless appearances at sci-fi conventions all over the country. Big Trouble in Little China. This 1986 action comedy directed by John Carpenter is absolutely balls to the wall, ridiculous, weird, and self-aware. It doesn't give a shit about how silly it is, its use of old cliches and Asian stereotypes. It's just here to have fun. And the actors definitely had fun.
Okay, you people sit tight, hold the fort, and keep the home fires burning. And if we're not back by dawn, call the president.
James Hong played Lo Pan.
You mean the David Lo Pan that's chairman of the National Orient Bank and owns the Wing Kong Import-Export Trading Company, but who's so reclusive that no one's even laid eyes on this guy in years?
Who the hell are you, anyway?
Centuries ago, he was a great warrior and wizard who died in battle and was the victim of an ancient curse. In order to break it, he needs to marry a woman with green eyes.
What's going on here? Is this some kind of...
Magic. The darkest magic. My soul swims in it, scattered across time, trapped in the world of formlessness, until I find her and marry her.
Marry her?
A girl with green eyes. A girl who can tame the burning blade.
In an interview for BladeZone.com, James talks about his experience. I did Lo Pan the best I could. I was very happy and still am happy with that performance. I created something that I thought was very evil, but with a great sense of humor. And we ad-libbed a lot. I love ad-libbing because of that comedy career. Like that line that people remember, as I wheel my wheelchair up to the TV and I see somebody entering the building, I said,
"Now this really pisses me off to no end."
That's ad-libbed. And they kept quite a few of those, whether it's that magic that we did with our funny little hand motions and whatnot. All that stuff was fun. A lot of fun. Everybody had fun on it. One thing I always find myself thinking about is how an actor remembers the experience of a film. What may have been just a fun, mindless action movie to some people really meant a lot to him.
This is a movie that's within our hearts. I went back to 20th Century Fox not long ago and saw that stage. When I stepped in the doors, I couldn't help but just almost cry because it did make a lot of us what we are today. And then on top of it, I was eating a Dupar. That's all I could afford, of course. And who should come up to me from the next table? Couldn't recognize him at first, John Carpenter.
Oh.
I looked up and he said, "John Carpenter." Oh, I couldn't believe it. I just got up and hugged him. There are some films that you do and it come and go, like RIP, R.I.P. And there's plenty more films on the horizon for me, but there will be never another Big Trouble in Little China.
You know, he implies that this film made him who he is today, but even without this, he'd still be working. I know he would. I guess it's impossible to really tell how much this role impacted his career. I'm sure it made casting directors notice him a little more, but he would have been fine without it. Okay, we got one last box, people, and unfortunately, this is not organized very well at all. We're halfway through this massive IMDb page. It's huge.
Doesn't take Charlie Chan to figure that one out.
It's impossible for me to mention everything, but I think I found a decent way to organize it. First, let's start off simple and just get through the highlights. These are the projects that you've definitely seen him in. Golden Child.
Oh, Mr. Gerald. You honor my shop with your presence.
Seinfeld.
Excuse me, I'm expecting a call. Costanza?
Yes, I just got a call. I yell, "Cartwright! Cartwright!" Just like that. Nobody came up, I hang up.
Well, was it for Costanza or?
Yes, yes, that's it. Nobody answered.
Was it a woman?
Yes, yes. I tell her, "You're not here." She said, "Curse word," I hang up.
One of my favorites, Wayne's World 2.
Very well. If that is your custom, prepare to die.
Mulan.
Silence! You would do well to teach your daughter to hold her tongue in a man's presence.
Balls of Fury.
In my hand, I hold a cricket.
What do that for? Don't take the cricket from my hand. Who the hell's to take the cricket from my hand? I just put it back. That is my lucky cricket.
Well, he flew out of my hand, man.
You squished him?
Nah.
You squish lucky cricket?
No.
Thanks a lot, kid.
The remake of The Day the Earth Stood Still.
For many years, I cursed my luck for being sent here. Human life is difficult. But as this life is coming to an end, I consider myself lucky to have lived it.
And Kung Fu Panda 1, 2, and 3.
What were you doing up there? All that noise?
Oh, nothing. Just had a crazy dream.
About what?
Huh?
What were you dreaming about?
Noodles.
Noodles?
And besides Kung Fu Panda, he's also done tons of voiceover work, which I'm not going to get into. He's been everywhere. Kid shows, Adult Swim shows, video games. Chances are you've heard him somewhere. Now, there are a few specific roles I want to mention. One role that James is particularly proud of is Shin, a private investigator with a heroin addiction in the 1987 crime drama Black Widow. He only has a few scenes, but I thought he did a great job.
No knock. Come into a person's office. No knock.
I'm sorry.
I knock. I come to your office, I knock. What were you born anyway?
His character is addicted to heroin, and in this scene, before he's killed, he's given one last chance to use.
Hey, wait a minute. Why are you doing this?
It's in the drawer, isn't it? Look. You have 5 seconds.
Wait, wait!
Another role that I loved was his character in the 1990 film The Two Jakes. It's a sequel to Chinatown that takes place 16 years later, and James reprises his role as Khan, the butler. Now, in Chinatown, he barely had any dialogue. In The Two Jakes, he has this wonderful scene with Jack Nicholson, and all of a sudden, instead of just being window dressing, we see Khan as a three-dimensional character.
Where did she go from here? If she's in trouble, I just want to help her, that's all.
No, no, if she is in trouble, you would not be the one to help. Like her, you are a prisoner of the past. You would do her more harm than good. Such things have happened. Wherever fate has taken her, I'm sure that she is grateful for what you've done for her. Isn't that enough?
It's low-key and simple. Here's another one, the film Shanghai Kiss. Near the end of the film, our main character reconciles with James, his father.
I loved her.
I know. I'm sorry.
It's a great scene, and I had never seen James do something so emotional. Okay, let's take one last intermission. Here's a collection of scenes taken completely out of context from the 1999 film Singapore Sling. There are a lot of credits left here. It's worth mentioning that James continued to play versions of the old wise man, either for dramatic effect, like in Bloodsport 2.
No need to touch. To achieve the iron hand, one must live it, be it, attain a certain inner peace and focus.
Or comedic effect, like in this scene where he's trying to help a couple guys last longer during sex in the comedy How to Make Love to a Woman.
It will make your mind grow. Then you can arrive at the party anytime.
And what if that doesn't work?
Try taking a sh**.
He also continued to play roles in which he was a waiter or restaurant worker, and a few here and there where he played some kind of Chinese ambassador or politician. We should also address the rest of James's directing career. Now, it wasn't necessarily porn, but it's a blurry line sometimes. In 1989, he co-wrote and co-directed a sci-fi horror movie called The Vineyard. It's pretty campy and actually fun to watch. James played Dr. Poe, a suave wine connoisseur who's been keeping himself young and healthy with the help of a magic potion.
Grant me eternal life. Give it to me. Give it to me!
There's violence, zombies, and a few graphic sex scenes, one of them with James. His character also has a dungeon full of scantily clad women chained to the ceiling.
Bastard.
Looks like your schooling days are over, my dear.
Ew. Then 10 years later, he directed the 1999 film Singapore Sling, which also had another title, Scandalous Behavior. The first half of it is pretty much softcore porn. A lot of graphic sex scenes, none of them real, but they go on for a long time. Now the plot. There's oil tycoons, and this chick escaped from a prison in Singapore. Okay. I figured it out. So James Hong plays this character, Adam Chance, and he married this chick in Singapore, but she only married him to avoid prison time, and then she escaped. I mean, she was in prison, but she escaped... Not prison, but she escaped China and came to America. So now he's come to America to find her. Nowhere can I find any mention from James about his involvement in these films.
I'm a real cowboy.
Doing. I saw that in a movie once.
Maybe nobody's thought to ask him, or perhaps since he's found success recently as a voiceover artist in a beloved series of children's films and cartoons, he might not want to talk about it. I don't know if that's the case, but if it is, I wouldn't worry about it, James. This stuff is so far in the past, nobody gives a It kind of heightens your cult status in a way. Besides all these films and TV shows I've mentioned, there's very little that stands out as unique. And that's not his fault. There's just a lot of stuff that he did that he had already done before.
In a sense, I haven't done too much except smaller roles and television since Big Trouble Little China.
Now, why is this? I think there are multiple reasons at play. First, there's the legend factor. At this point in James Hong's career, he had been around for a while, and I believe that he had finally reached that point that a lot of character actors reach in their old age. They're instantly recognizable, and people will point at the screen and say, "Oh, I love him!" They may not know his name, but they've definitely seen him before. And I'm taking a leap here, but I'm gonna make an educated guess that he also became very well known within the industry, and had gotten a reputation for being a reliable go-to guy. Secondly, he loves doing comedy.
What is that?
Fleshlight. Oh, but that's not for you.
What does it do?
Some say that it turns fantasy into reality.
Awesome.
I would say comedy is my first love, you know, because I did come from that long period of doing stand-up comedy in high school and in college. It's ingrained in me, and I love comedy in the sense that you have to smile and laugh with life. You can't be too down. If you take it too seriously, you're gonna cut your own throat, you know.
Thirdly, there's the stereotype factor. A lot of Asian actors nowadays, including James, have talked about how there still aren't a lot of opportunities for Asian actors to play lead characters. Now, I didn't know much about all this going in, and after spending so much time in this world, I'm gonna agree with them. Now, I'm not gonna get into why I think that, because it's not relevant, but I do want to bring up one thing because it'll help me make a point about James's career. In this interview for BBC Radio 1 Extra, Nightcrawler and the Night Of actor Riz Ahmed talks about how he thinks there are three stages that ethnic actors go through.
First of all, you get the stereotypes, right? If you're East Asian, you're gonna play the Kung Fu master. If you're Asian, you're gonna play the shopkeeper, taxi driver, terrorist. Then you move on from that. You move on to stage two. Stage two is, it is about Kung Fu. It is about gun crime and drug dealing. It's about terrorism. But we switch the stereotypes, we flip them. So suddenly this drug dealer is not a baddie, he's humanized, maybe. We get to see things from their point of view. And then finally you get to stage three, and that's where we're getting to. That's the promised land. That's where people like Noel and Idris, and I've been lucky as well to do some of those films as well, that kind of, he's just a guy. You're just a guy. Yeah, the color of his skin happens to be whatever, but he's just a guy.
It seems like most of James's career has been in those first two stages, but very rarely has he ever been just a guy. Now, all that aside, I'm sure that the stereotype thing has limited James in some way, but I thought of something that kind of makes sense. James is in his late 80s. He may have been born in Minneapolis, but since his father made the decision to move the family back to Hong Kong when James was 4, and then come back to America when James was a teenager, you could pretty much consider James a first-generation Chinese immigrant. It also sounds to me like the Chinese culture was very important to James's father, not wanting his family to become too Americanized. This brings us back to something we've touched on before, the history of a character. Since James can't really play younger anymore, any character that he plays in modern day would share certain aspects of James's history, based solely on his generation. For example, a character that James plays, more than likely, would have a strong Chinese accent, because he's not as Americanized. It's also not crazy to suggest a character James would play may work in a dry cleaner's or at a Chinese restaurant, because a lot of second-generation Chinese immigrants and their fathers grew up in those businesses. There are also certain personal experiences that are unique to someone of James's age. Did you ever notice how much James mutters and shouts angrily in Chinese sometimes?
One bowl of chili, a lot of mess.
Not helping your violin music either.
Violin music, hey, you don't call Brahms violin music.
I'm going to bring you the four dumplings. When I'm walking over to the table, maybe I get bumped. One of the dumplings fall to the floor. No one has to know.
I'll know.
Well, that's something that he had heard a lot growing up in his generation.
And I would a lot of times mutter in Chinese because I had grown up in Minneapolis in my father's store. Downstairs in the store where the Chinese would gather on weekends to gamble and to just associate with each other. And so I would hear this constant chattering, loud chattering of the men, the laundrymen and restaurant people gathered to play cards and dominoes, Chinese pai gui. And so, you know, all that, I was living upstairs as a kid, so it just become ingrained into my mind. If I miss that, then I go to Phoenix Inn down Chinatown on Spring Street. And I hear those, you know, I go there to refresh myself of so-called the village inside of Chinatown, or the Chinese life that lives within the characters that of the people who came from China. You know, and miss China and miss their hometown.
Now let's say we're talking about younger generations of American Asian or British Asian actors, like John Cho, Benedict Wong, Randall Park, Daniel Dae Kim, John Fu, Constance Wu, Margaret Cho, Stephen Yeun, or Bobby Lee. If any of these people were to audition for Asian roles in projects that take place during modern day, their characters would undoubtedly be more Americanized, or Britannized, however you say it, like they were, just based on age and background of the actors alone. All of these actors pretty much grew up in America or the UK, and they didn't live through a depression or a world war, and arguably didn't experience racism firsthand on the scale of an Asian who grew up in that era. Now, taking all of that into account, just because James Hong is the generation that he is, doesn't mean he has to play these less Americanized Chinese roles. He's just really good at it.
Very lovely.
But just because you're more likely to play these types of roles also doesn't mean that they have to be so limited. You can still write a nuanced, beautiful, three-dimensional character. There probably aren't a lot out there, and James is busy taking all the work he can get.
An old Chinese guy?
It seems like he'll do anything, and maybe that's not a bad thing. There's such a negative connotation that comes with saying, oh, he'll do anything, but the fact that he's worked so much has just put him on the map in his own right. And he gives it his all, no matter how small the role is. Even really obscure indie films, where I'm sure he was just on set for a day, you can tell that he delivers. Even besides films, he's also just in random YouTube videos. When I was searching clips of him on YouTube, I found him popping up on obscure YouTube channels that I had never heard of. He played a waiter at a Pokemon restaurant for this sketch comedy YouTube channel.
Enjoying yourselves, I see. Well, young man, how do you like your surf and turf?
Oh, it's delicious.
Thank you. And you?
Amazing. Thanks for upgrading me to the Pidgeotto legs.
No problem at all.
I mean, no offense, but how did they get James Hong? I couldn't get James Hong. I tried emailing him. And what about this cooking show where he just appeared and helps this guy make a beef stew?
My name is Chef Boyardee. Actually, I was only kidding. My name is George Takei.
Were there countless videos of him at conventions, dancing with fans, taking pictures, doing the Harlem Shake, quoting lines from his movies to adults and children alike?
Maybe you better not go, Paul! Did you remember that?
Sure, I'll take a picture with you. Sure, I'll make a face for the camera. He loves it all. And yet, I get the feeling that despite his wild success, he's slightly disappointed that he hasn't played a substantial role in a film or TV show.
It's about time I got another role that's a good one. I need a big science fiction film of some kind.
Maybe he doesn't need a big role in anything. Maybe he's made more of an impact as simply James Hong. At the end of his interview for the Archive of American Television, the interviewer asks him,
"How would you like to be remembered?"
I guess just as a good actor and a good fellow man and a wonderful human being.
From what I've seen, I think that about sums it up. At the time this episode was released, on February 22nd, 2017, James Hong is 88 years old and still acting.
February 22nd? This is gonna blow your mind. On February 22nd, Mr. James Hong turns 88 years old. Give it up. Hey, on the count of three, can we say happy birthday, James? Just shout it out. One, two, three. Happy birthday, James!
Yeah, I'm still here. I'm still alive. And, you know, I'm still available, and my agent is CESD.
He's been married since 1977 to his second wife, Susan, and has one daughter, April. He's one of the founding members of the East-West Players, an Asian-American theater organization in L.A. that was established in 1965 to further expose Asian and Pacific Islander art and artists to a wider audience. He also teaches the Hong Acting Workshop, alongside his daughter April, who's also an actress. You can check out their website on jameshong.com. They have a lot of different services, including acting classes for all ages, public speaking, parties, and special events. And James Hong's sense of humor permeates, even in the website. Like when you click on Contact Us and you see this. Jesus. Alright guys, it took a while, but I think we got everything. Honestly, I don't think we even need to get into it. I mean, you watched this video to learn about James Hong, right? We did that. Granted, we had to get some of the stereotype stuff out of the way, but this? James's only experience with yellowface was when he was in Charlie Chan, and he pretty much said what a lot of other Asian actors said about it.
When they play the Asians, they put that eyepiece on. I hated those eyepieces.
That's simple enough. So instead of veering off into something that's way off topic, let's just end here.
We've come full circle, and yet we may have more questions than answers, but one thing's for sure, James Hong is everywhere. He's a part of all those radio and television waves that continue to ripple out to the far reaches of the universe. Perhaps one day, long after we're gone, some alien civilization will come across a television signal that was broadcasted thousands of years ago, when Big Trouble in Little China may have aired late on a Sunday night.
I have established the link.
And with any luck, they'll be very confused at what they see.
We'd better run. Run it through the mystic night. Run until they take. You can feel the fun.